Welcome to the Journal. For months now, revelations of the wholesale greed and blatant transgressions of Wall Street have reminded us that the best way to rob a bank is to own one. In fact, the man you're about to meet wrote a book with just that title. It was based upon his experience as a tough regulator during one of the darkest chapters in our financial history, the savings and loan scandal in the late 1980s.
These numbers, as very large as they are, vastly understate the problem of fraud.
Bill Black was in New York this week for a conference at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, where scholars and journalists gathered to ask the question, how do they get away with it? Well, no one has asked that question more often than Bill Black. The former director of the Institute for Fraud Prevention now teaches economics and law at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. During the savings and loan crisis, it was Black who accused then House Speaker Jim Wright and five U.S. senators, including John Glenn and John McCain, of doing favors for the SNLs in exchange for contributions and other perks. The senators got off with a slap on the wrist, but so enraged was one of those bankers, Charles Keating, after whom the Senate's so-called Keating Five were named, he sent a memo that read in part, "Get Black, kill him dead." Metaphorically, of course. Of course. Now he's focused on an even greater scandal, and he spares no one, not even the president he worked hard to elect, Barack Obama. But his main target are the Wall Street barons who are heirs of an earlier generation whose scandalous ripoffs of wealth back in the 1930s earned them comparison to Al Capone and the mob, and the nickname, Banksters. Bill Black, welcome to the Journal.
Thank you.
I was taken with your candor at the conference here in New York to hear you say that this crisis we're going through, this economic and financial meltdown, is driven by fraud. What's your definition of fraud?
Fraud is deceit. And the essence of fraud is I create trust in you, and then I betray that trust and get you to give me something of value. And as a result, there's no more effective acid against trust than fraud, especially fraud by top elites. And that's what we have.
In your book, you make it clear that calculated dishonesty by people in charge is at the heart of most large corporate failures and scandals, including, of course, the SNL. But is that true? Is that what you're saying here, that it was in the boardrooms and the CEO offices where this fraud began?
Absolutely.
How did they do it? What do you mean?
Well, the way that you do it is to make really bad loans because they pay better. Then you grow extremely rapidly. In other words, you're a Ponzi-like scheme. And the third thing you do is we call it leverage. That just means borrowing a lot of money. And the combination creates a situation where you have guaranteed record profits in the early years. That makes you rich through the bonuses that its modern executive compensation has produced. It also makes it inevitable that there's going to be a disaster down the road.
So you're suggesting or saying that CEOs of some of these banks and mortgage firms, in order to increase their own personal income, deliberately set out to make bad loans?
Yes.
How do they get away with it? I mean, what about their own checks and balances in the company? What about their accounting divisions?
All of those checks and balances report to the CEO. So if the CEO goes bad, all of the checks and balances are easily overcome. And the art form is not simply to defeat those internal controls, but to suborn them, to turn them into your greatest allies. And the bonus programs are exactly how you do that.
If I wanted to go looking for the parties to this with a good bird dog, where would you send me?
Well, that's exactly what hasn't happened. We haven't looked, right? The Bush administration essentially got rid of regulation. So if nobody was looking, you were able to do this with impunity, and that's exactly what happened. Where would you look? You'd look at the specialty lenders, the lenders that did almost all of their work in the subprime and what's called Alt-A, liar's loans.
Liar's loans. Why did they call them liar's loans?
Because they were liar's loans.
And they knew it?
They knew it. They knew that they were frauds. Liar's loans mean that we don't check. You tell us what your income is, you tell us what your job is, you tell us what your assets are, and we agree to believe you. We won't check on any of those things. And by the way, you get a better deal if you inflate your income and your job history and your assets.
You think they really said that to borrowers?
We know that they said that to borrowers. In fact, they were also called in the trade ninja loans.
Ninja?
Yeah, because no income verification, no job verification, no asset verification.
You're talking about significant American companies.
Huge. One company produced as many losses as the entire savings and loan debacle.
Which company?
IndyMac, specialized in making liar's loans. In 2006 alone, it sold $80 billion of liar's loans to other companies. $80 billion.
And was this happening exclusively in this subprime mortgage business?
No, and that's a big part of the story as well. Even prime loans began to have non-verification. Even Ronald Reagan, you know, said trust but verify.
Right.
They just gutted the verification process. We know that will produce enormous fraud under economic theory, criminology theory, and 2,000 years of life experience.
Is it possible that these complex instruments were deliberately created so swindlers could exploit them?
Oh, absolutely. This stuff, the exotic stuff that you're talking about, was created out of things like liar's loans that were known to be extraordinarily bad. And now it was getting AAA ratings. Now, a AAA rating is supposed to mean there is zero credit risk. So you take something that not only has significant, it has crushing risk. That's why it's toxic. And you create this fiction that it has zero risk. That itself, of course, is a fraudulent exercise. And again, there was nobody looking during the Bush years. So finally, only a year ago, we started to have a congressional investigation of some of these rating agencies. And it's scandalous what came out. What we know now is that the rating agencies never looked at a single loan file. When they finally did look, after the markets had completely collapsed, they found, and I'm quoting Fitch, the smallest of the rating agencies, the results were disconcerting in that there was the appearance of fraud in nearly every file we examined.
So if your assumption is correct, your evidence is sound, the bank, the lending company, created a fraud, and the ratings agency that is supposed to test the value of these assets knowingly entered into the fraud. Both parties are committing fraud by intention.
Right, and the investment banker that we call it pooling puts together these bad mortgages, the liar's loans, and creates the toxic waste of these derivatives. All of them do that. And then they sell it to the world, and the world just thinks that because it has a AAA rating, it must actually be safe. Well, instead, there are 60 and 80% losses on these things because, of course, in reality, they are toxic waste.
You're describing what Bernie Madoff did to a limited number of people, but you're saying it's systemic, a systemic Ponzi scheme.
Oh, Bernie was a piker. He doesn't even get into the front ranks of a Ponzi scheme.
But you're saying our system became a Ponzi scheme.
Our system
became financial system.
A Ponzi scheme. Everybody was buying a pig in the poke, but they were buying a pig in a poke with a pretty pink ribbon, and the pink ribbon said AAA.
Is there a law against liar's loan?
Not directly, but there are, of course, many laws against fraud, and liar's loans are fraudulent.
Because?
Because they're not going to be repaid and because they have false representations. They involve deceit, which is the essence of fraud.